Good morning. I hope I am audible to you. Okay. In case if you have a doubt from the other class on Friday, please raise your hand. I'll address your doubt. If you have a doubt, just raise your hand. Raise your hand matlab in the participants panel. Okay, excellent, excellent. Akriti Verma, you have given me a tick. Is that for a doubt? Yeah. Akriti, can go ahead and talk. I've unmuted you.
Sir, we were studying that in the Delhi Sultanate period, there were 34 rulers in all. But yeah. I was just looking online out of curiosity. I was looking for something else. So on many websites, they have said that there were 32 rulers only. So which is the, I'm confused about that.
It's okay. Whatever I'm telling you is an official number from the standard books. You cannot trust all online sources. Especially right. Wikipedia and Quora.
All right, sir.
Your source was Quora. I'm really sorry. Please don't ever refer to that in the future. Or for that matter, right. Wikipedia, anybody can edit these sources. I suppose you understand. Okay, so before giving you a fact, we do lots of research and then only put that in the public domain. I hope you understand.
Right, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, sure. And there is a question in the chat window. Let me address that. The question is, Tarush Pandey is asking, sir, is it all right to read directly from the blue books and just have an overview of NCERT? Yeah, that's also fine. If NCERT is too easy for you, that's also fine. See, blue workbooks, there has been lots of work behind the blue workbooks. The data in blue workbooks has been sourced from approximately, 10, 15 books, as well as the insight of the faculty about the subject. Are you getting it? So it's like putting all these books into a mixer grinder and grinding them together, giving you the output. It's a juice of these books. Are you getting it? But we cannot incorporate all the pages from NCERT into the blue workbooks. I hope you understand, because NCERT runs for a length of approximately 300 pages. So do the other books. I hope you understand. So we have given the gist, the crux of all these books in the blue workbooks. How to remember all that? I have already told you the trick to remembering everything is to remember nothing. You should not try to remember. You should enjoy the process. Then all the data will come to you automatically, like a movie song. The trick to this is reading a single source multiple times. I think we'll stop the questions with that for the time being. And let us go back to the assignment that I've given you on Friday. I've given you quite a few number of terms to read and be familiar with, right? If my memory is right, the first term should have been Jagirdar. Yes? Can somebody tell me who a Jagirdar was? Raise your hand, I'll allow you to speak. Yes? Raise your hand fast. Yes? Nikhil, Nandini, Kandelwa, Lishan, Ajay. Ishan, I've seen you speak only once, so let me give you a chance. I'm allowing Ishan to speak. Aisha, go ahead.
So Jagirdars were essentially officials who were given a gift of land by the Mughal king, the Mughal emperor. Yeah. This revenue claim was non-hereditary in nature. And the only element was that there was a revenue claim that could be made by that Jagirdar over the piece of land that's been given as a gift. And they could also supervise the Zamindars, if I'm not mistaken, but I'm not sure about that.
Okay. Simply put, Jagirdars were Mughal officials. Jagirdars could have been Mughal officials. Generally, they were Mughal officials. They could have been given a piece of land if the emperor so wished. Since they were officials, they could appropriate their salary from the revenue collected from that land. I hope you understand. Jagir, land. Jagirdar, the person who controlled the land. So the next term, I think, was Zamindar. Yeah. Zamindar, Nandini, can you go ahead and answer this question?
Yes, sir. So they were the holders of revenue rights without obligation to perform any duty other than revenue collection. They collected the revenue.
This is a standard statement in a UPSC question. if I'm not wrong, maybe in 2019. Second statement, I suppose we'll see that later. But let me correct you. You are partly right. Zamindars were local chieftains or local chiefs. For example, in a village. Yeah. Nandini, I hope you've answered the question. So make sure that you have lowered your hand.
Yes.
Okay, Rahul. Why don't you answer one question? What is the next term, Rahul?
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, yeah. Excellent.
Sir, it was a system introduced by Akbar.
Yeah.
In recommendation of his revenue minister, Raja Todarmal.
Raja Todarmal, yes. Correct.
According to the system, the average production of last 10 year was taken.
Excellent.
And what they have done is that 1/3 of this average was fixed as for the kingdom and rest 2/3 was given for the cultivators.
Excellent. You would have come across the term small. Don't go into the technicalities of it. Just understand, Raja Todarmal, the finance minister of Akbar, devised the system of land revenue collection. For assessing the land revenue in a particular year, he evaluated the average produce in the previous 10 years. Based on the production in the previous 10 years, he arrived at a figure by taking the average. So that average was considered to be the production in that particular year. And of that production value, 1/3 was charged as a revenue. Why Dashala? 10 years. It was based on 10 years average. That's why Dashala system. I hope you understand. Okay, we'll ask Prinkesh. I could understand that he was asking for an opportunity. Yeah. Shambhavi, I'll come to your doubt. You have raised your hand, I could see. I'll come to your doubt later after this term. Yes. Prinkesh?
The next term is jizya.
Jizya, excellent. A tricky term.
Yeah, the tax levied by Muslim rulers on certain permanent non-Muslim residents of the Muslim territory. It was jizya.
So based on these terms, let me give you a question. It was a question by UPSC in 2019, I suppose. With reference to Mughal India, what are the differences between Jagirdar and Zamindar? Based on these two statements, you have to choose the correct option between A, B, C, D. And tell me what could be the right answer in the chat box. Wow. See, that's the beauty with any subject. Once you understand the concepts, right, you can never go wrong. As we have seen in the definitions of these terms, the first statement is wrong. So is the second statement. So the correct answer choice would be D. Neither one, nor two. As simple as that. Let me elaborate because you have to understand the idea.